My name is Abhishek Bakshi. I am working as assistant professor in the Department of Zoology, Mahatma Gandhi Government Arts College, Mahi, Union Territory of Puducherry, India. This is my third video in this series of lectures of zoology. In this series of lectures, I am discussing the different physiological processes of rabbit, Oryctolagus cuniculus. So today I will begin my discussion on circulatory system of rabbit. My today's lecture is mainly focusing on anatomy of circulatory system of rabbit. So let's begin. The circulatory or blood vascular system of rabbit, and for that matter any mammal, consists of three constituent structures. One, the circulating media, which is known as blood, the fluid which flows. Number two, the pathways, the tubular system, the vascular system, which gives its name, the blood vascular system, the channels through which the blood flows, what we call as the blood vessels. And number third, the pump which pushes the blood through these vascular structures, heart, the central pumping organ which pumps blood in the blood vessels. The blood vascular system of rabbit is of closed type. In animal kingdom, there are two kinds of blood vascular system. One which is known as open type and the another which is known as closed type. In open type of blood vascular system, the body fluid or the blood comes in direct contact with the visceral or internal organs of the animal. And the exchange of materials many times takes place directly with the different tissues and organs of the body. However, in case of higher animals and all vertebrates, the blood vascular system is of closed type. In closed type of blood vascular system, the blood never leaves vascular system at all. It remains always confined either within the pumping heart or the different blood vessels. It remain confined within these structures and keep circulating. The exchange of materials always takes through the walls of a specialized blood vessel capillaries by the process of diffusion. So exchange of material, whether it is the addition or subtraction, whether it's something is needed to be added to the blood or it is needed to be taken from the blood, it all happens by the mechanism of diffusion through the wall of capillaries by the process of diffusion. So basically this system, this organization of this organ system is what we call as the transportation mechanism of any animal. This organ system, this circulatory system, is basically responsible for the transportation of every kind of material within the body of an animal, whether it is the digested nutrients which is needed to be transported from the intestinal wall to different tissues of the body, or it may be the respiratory gases which is needed to be transported from different tissues, the carbon dioxide waste, to the lungs, alveoli, so that it can be exhaled out, or it may be a regulatory molecule like hormones which is needed to be distributed from the site of its secretion to the site of its action. Even the waste material which are generated by each and every cell and tissue of the body is being transported by this blood vascular system. So basically this circulatory system is transportation mechanism of any animal, which transports each and everything from one part of the body to the another part, from one organ to the another organ, from one tissue to another tissues, from one cell to another cell, from the site of its production to the site of its utilization. So let's begin our discussion on the three ingredients of this circulatory system. So first we will start with the blood itself, the transportation vehicle, the fluid connective tissue which flows within the blood vessels. The blood consists of two major ingredients, its fluid matrix, what is known as plasma, and its suspended particles, what is known as the formed elements of the blood, which includes all the different kinds of blood cells and other constituents, particulate structures. Basically or physically, blood of rabbit is a suspension solution, or more accurately, it is a suspended solid cells or the organized structures, what constitutes the formed elements. They are suspended along with the plasma, the fluid material in which many things they are dissolved. So basically blood is a colloidal structure, not purely suspension. It is a colloidal solution. Some of the particulate structures, they are suspended, the larger blood cells and platelet like structures, whereas many smaller molecules like the ions and the small molecules like the glucose and salts, they remain dissolved in the blood plasma. So the main blood cells, which are known as the blood corpuscles, they are RBCs, red blood cells, erythrocytes, WBCs, leukocytes, and platelets, thrombocytes. So before going in detail with these blood cells, in mammals, out of the total volume of the blood, 55% of its volume is made up of its fluid matrix, that is plasma, whereas 45% of its volume is made up of these formed structures, which includes all the different blood cells and small particulate structures or suspended molecules like the thrombocytes. So the first important cell of the blood is erythrocytes. More popularly, it is known as the RBCs or red blood cells. The color of blood is because of the presence of this particular cell, because of its large number. The red color of the blood is due to this presence of a particular pigment, what we call as the hemoglobin. It is an iron containing pigment, and it is this pigment which is responsible for the transportation of respiratory oxygen from the alveoles of the lungs of the rabbit to the each and every tissue and cell of the rabbit's body. The blood of rabbit resembles that of other mammals in all the structural and functional details. However, it also exhibits some differences. Now, this diagram, this is a representative diagram of the different kinds of blood cells. Here you can see the structure of the RBCs, the red blood cells, or what is known as the erythrocytes. These are the all different leukocytes. I'll come to these cells. So these are the RBCs of the rabbit body. Now, the erythrocytes of the rabbit, they are comparatively small. This diagram is actually very nicely made with the proportionate sizes. So you can see the comparative size of the WBCs with that of the RBC. RBCs are actually less than half in the diameter with comparison to most of the WBCs. The erythrocytes of rabbit, they are quite small. They are nearly 7.5 micrometers in diameter. They are circular and biconcave. They are disc-like structure, which you can see that they have embedded, or what you can say, they have caved like structure from both the ends of the side. It is discoidal and they are quite numerous. The biconcave shape of rabbit's erythrocytes are because of absence of any internal cellular organelle. Erythrocytes of mammals, does not erythrocyte of mammals does not have any internal cellular organelle, not even the nucleus. This modification or this evolutionary adaptation has done in order to accommodate maximum or more amount of hemoglobin for the efficient transportation of respiratory gases. The number of erythrocytes, however, is quite large in rabbit. It is 5 million per millimeter cube of the blood, that is per ml of the blood. 5 into 10 raised to the power 6, it is large. And it is because of this large number, the color of the blood of rabbit appears red. The thrombocytes or the blood platelets of rabbit are irregular, non-nucleated, and they are more in number. These are the platelets of the rabbit blood, and these are the basic major points what is specifically confined to the rabbits and what is different from the other with comparison to the other mammals. The second major category of the blood corpuscles are the white blood cells or leukocytes. There are two major categories, or what we can say, the subcategories of the leukocytes on the basis of the presence of these fine granules in their cytoplasm. So here you can see the fine granular structures are there in this cell and in this cell and even in these cells, in this cell. These three cells, these are known as granulocytes because of the presence of the granules in the cytoplasm, whereas the remaining two categories, these two, the monocytes and lymphocytes, they belong to the second category known as non-granulocytes. So granulocytes are of three further subcategories on the basis of the reaction of granules to the dyes, or rather we can say on the basis of their granular nature. So the first category is what we call as the eosinophils, or these are also known as acidophils. So this is the eosinophil, which is having numerous granules. The nature of these granules are basically alkaline in nature, and hence these granules show high affinity towards one of the acidic dye, eosine, and they get easily stained with the help of eosine dye. Hence the name is given as the eosinophil. Please remember this thing very clearly, that acidophils or eosinophils granules are basic or alkaline. Hence they are capable to absorb or get stained with eosinophil. The second granulocyte is basophil, which is the contrary or the contrasting leukocyte with the granules which are acidic in nature, and hence they show affinity towards the basic dye. The most popular basic dye which is used to stain the basophils are basophilic granules is methylene blue. And there is a third category of granulocyte in rabbit blood, the WBC of this particular category, what is known as neutrophils. The granules of this cell, this WBC granulocyte, does not show any specific affinity towards either acidic or alkaline dye. Rather, it is neutral in nature, hence it is known as neutrophils. All the granulocytes, whether it is a eosinophil or basophils or neutrophils, their nucleus, they are multilobed. The second category is known as non-granulocytes, or more popularly as the agranulocytes. It comprises two major categories of the cells, the largest WBC monocytes and small lymphocytes. The lymphocytes are the smallest WBC. In fact, it is slightly larger than the RBCs in size. Lymphocytes are further of two subcategories. One, what is known as the T lymphocyte, which matures functionally in thymus, and the second one is known as B lymphocytes, which matures within the bone marrow itself. Both these cells, the monocytes and lymphocytes together, they constitutes the agranulocytes, and they are quite abundant in the blood cells. Both these categories of granulocytes are phagocytic, and they are basically the defense structures of the body. In fact, all the WBCs, all these five categories, they are the defense system of rabbit's body. Monocytes are circulating, and they have one particular nature that while circulating, they sneak out from the blood circulation and enters into the tissue fluid, where they get modifies into the particular kind of macrophages. Every different tissue of the rabbit's body have a different kind of macrophage, and those macrophages are nothing else, they are modified monocytes which have left the circulating blood, entered into the tissue fluid, and became specialized as per that particular tissue. Now, what are the functions of this fluid connective tissue, blood? Blood has multiple functions. So it is the primary transporting vehicle of the different molecules. So of course, there are many other functions, but the first and the foremost function of the blood is transportation. It moves from the heart to the various organs, where everything which is needed or which is not needed are either added or taken away from it. But remember, again, I am repeating, earlier also I have mentioned, all the exchange of materials, whether it is needed to be taken from the blood or whether it is needed to be added in the blood, it all happens, all the exchange happens in the different tissues across the thin capillary walls by the process of diffusion or by the process of osmosis, etc. So blood picks up oxygen from the lungs, nutrients from the digestive tract, and transport these to the different tissues where they are needed. It also picks up the transport cellular waste like the carbon dioxide, nitrogenous waste like the urea, uric acid, ammonia, and it carries it to the site of the rabbit's body, like the lungs, from where the carbon dioxide is removed by the process of exhalation in order to remove the nitrogenous waste and the other cellular waste. It takes the blood takes it to the nephrons of the kidneys, where it gets filtered out and is excreted by the mechanism of the excretion with the kidney by forming urine. So this all material which get transported across the different parts of the body, it is done with the help of the blood. So that is one of the primary function of the blood. The capillary exchanges keep the composition of tissue fluid within the normal limits, because every cell and tissue of the rabbit's body or any animal body, it always continuously carries out different metabolic processes, and for those metabolic processes, they continuously require some of the ingredients, raw material, like the nutrients and oxygen. And parallelly, they also generate some of the waste products like the nitrogenous. So all these materials which are needed are also transported by the blood, and all the wastes which are generated by these tissues, they are being taken away by the blood to the site of their removal from the body. So various organs and tissues secrete hormones and other messenger molecules also. They are also added in the blood, especially for the endocrine system. All the endocrine organs, they secrete their chemical messenger hormones directly into the blood, and then the blood transports these chemical messengers from the site of their production to their site of action. So with the help of the blood, these chemical molecules transport throughout the body, and they influence the cellular metabolism of their target tissue, where they get added to the receptor structures. The second major function of the blood is defense. Because of the presence of leukocytes, five different subcategories of the leukocytes, monocytes, lymphocytes, neutrophils, basophils, eosinophils, it carries out the major function of defense of the body against any kind of pathogenic infectious agents, microbes. In fact, not only that, this leukocytes also clears out the dead and dying cells. It also creates room for the growth of healthy cells. It also detects that if there is any cell which is converting into dangerous cancerous structures, it removes them. So neutrophils, for that example, is the circulating major phagocytic cell which can eat or engulf the bacterial cells or any other cells which are becoming dangerous. And similarly, the macrophages, which are the tissue cellular structure or modified structures of the monocytes, they also carry out the similar functions of phagocytosis in the different tissues of the body. Similarly, lymphocytes are one of the important leukocytes for the defense mechanism of the blood, as the B cells, the B lymphocytes, they generate the most important defense protein of the rabbit's body, known as antibodies or immunoglobulins. So antibodies are those protein molecules which incapacitate pathogens, making them subject to destruction by the other white blood cells, especially by the neutrophils and others. The third function of blood within the body of rabbit is to regulate and maintain body temperature by picking up heat mostly from the active muscles and transporting it throughout the body of the animal. Now, rabbit is a mammal, one of the homeothermic animal who maintains their body temperature constant, does not matter how the environmental temperature varies. And blood plays an important role in maintaining this body temperature by distributing the heat from the site of the highly metabolically active cells to the other parts of the body where the heat is not generated in that level. It also maintains the internal body temperature of the animal. But that is not the only regulatory function of the blood. Blood also regulates the osmotic pressure and salt and ionic concentration of the body. So basically, it acts as a buffer. The salts and plasma protein, they maintain the pH and osmotic pressure of the body. So all these things, body temperature, osmotic pressure, pH, all these functions are carried out by the blood. So blood is one of the major regulatory structure of rabbit's body. So these are the main three functions of the blood. Let's come to the next major structure of the circulatory system of rabbit, the central organ, heart, the one which pumps the blood. So the heart of rabbit lies in between the two lungs within the median space of the thoracic cavity. There is a small cavity-like structure in the thoracic region of rabbit. That space is known as mediastinum. Mediastinum is exactly not at the central thoracic portion. It is somewhat towards the left side of the thorax, and more or less 60-70% of the heart also lies on the left side of the rabbit's thorax. Externally, the rabbit's heart is pear-shaped, muscular, and it is a completely divided four-chambered heart. The pointed tip of the heart, what is known as the apex of the heart, is directed posteriorly, whereas the broader anterior portion is towards the front part of the rabbit's body. There is a transverse groove which distinctly separates the heart into the upper portion, the anterior portion, which is known as the auricular part, and there is a lower portion which is comparatively larger, known as the ventricular part. This groove, which is circular and which is present around the heart, is known as coronary sulcus, or it is also known as auriculoventricular groove because it divides the auricles from the ventricles. It is known as coronary sulcus because of its crown-like structure, as if a crown is fitted on the top, from the top in the middle of the heart, dividing the heart into the upper portion, that is the auricular portion, and the lower portion, that is the ventricular portion. Around the heart, there is a thin-walled, double-layered packaging is there. That bag is known as pericardium. It is double-layered structure, and these sac, these double-layered sac, protect the heart from any sort of injuries. The external part of the layer is known as parietal, whereas the inner layer is known as visceral pericardium. In between these two pericardial layer, there is a small narrow gap. That gap is known as pericardial cavity, which is filled with a watery fluid known as the pericardial fluid. So basically, heart is very well protected. So heart, a muscular structure, is enclosed within two concentric layers. Both layers together, they are known as pericardium. The outer one, which is parietal, the inner one is visceral. There is a fine gap in between them, and that gap is known as the pericardial cavity, which is having a watery pericardial fluid. Now, what is the significance of this fluid? Heart is one muscular organ which keeps on contracting and relaxing throughout the life of an animal. In fact, heart starts contracting and relaxing much before the birth of a mammal, and it keeps on contracting and relaxing or working till the last moment of any animal's life. So in order to avoid any kind of friction, any kind of regurgitation, any kind of injury to the external wall of the heart, this pericardial fluid is present, which acts as a lubricant. So basically, this pericardial fluid, which is present in between the external and internal pericardium, is the lubricant which allows a friction-free, smooth contraction and movement of the cardiac tissues. The internal visceral pericardium remains in direct contact with the epicardial layer of the heart structure. It also provides protection from any kind of external injury. So this is the diagrammatic representation of the rabbit's heart. This one is the dorsal view. So if you cut open the animal's body from the top, this is how the heart appears. And this is how it looks if you open it from the ventral side. This is what I was talking about, the coronary sulcus, which is dividing into the upper portion, which is, you can see very clearly, is smaller than the lower part. So this is the ventricular part, whereas this is the auricular part. And this is the coronary sulcus, which is going throughout the medial portion of the heart. These are the different major blood vessels which are present. So the upper portion, the auricular part, has two distinct auricle, the left and the right auricles, and this is the dorsal side where it can be seen as very clearly the left auricular portion and the right auricular portion. And from the lower side, it is not that distinct. That is, from the ventral side, it is not that detailed, joined with each other, because it is comparatively, the ventricles are much larger, which is very clearly seen. The left auricle is smaller than the right somewhat. It is not that small or that big. So it is slightly smaller than the right auricular portion. The sinus venosus is absent and it is merged with the right auricle. Now, many of the students, they have this query or this doubt that why the left auricle is smaller than the right. The reason is, left auricle receives blood through the pulmonary veins, whereas the right auricle receives blood through the vena cavae. That means basically, when we'll discuss the functioning of the heart, it will become more clear. But basically, the left auricle receives blood coming through the lungs only, whereas the right auricle collects blood coming from each and every tissue of the body. So that is the precise reason. The posterior part of each auricle is swollen like a flap-like structure, and this is known as the auricular appendix. So this part is the auricular appendix, which we call, which slightly covers the corresponding ventricles, as you can see. This lower portion, what is made up of the ventricles, it is the major part of the heart, and here also the distribution of the size are not same. In fact, if you look at this particular diagram, it becomes very clear. The left ventricle, as you can see, the dorsal side, this here, it is because of the posterior vena cava. The median groove is the longitudinal sulcus groove is not very clear, which divides the left and the right ventricle. But you can see this part is basically the left ventricle, whereas this part is the right ventricle. And this is the ventral view, where this is the right ventricle and this is the left ventricle. So basically, the left ventricle is larger, it is bigger, and this groove, which we call as the longitudinal groove or the longitudinal sulcus, it looks like it is passing through the medial portion, but it is not actually crossing through the exact middle. As you can see, this is the tip of the or apex of the heart, and the entire apex of the heart is within the left ventricle, and the right ventricle is a little bit on the right side of the heart, for that matter. So the ventricle is divided into right and left part by an oblique intraventricular groove, what I was telling you here, like this longitudinal sulcus extending from the top of the heart backwards towards the right, but not reaching to the apex. Therefore, left ventricle is bigger than the right ventricle and includes the apex of the heart. The conus or truncus arteriosus is absent in rabbit heart and it is merged with the ventricles. Internally, the heart is very clear cut, divided into completely four chambers, two auricles and two ventricles, left and the right auricles, left and right ventricles. And that is a characteristic feature of mammalian heart. In case of the auricles, they are comparatively thin walled. They are separated from each other. That is, the left auricle is separated from the right auricle with the help of a thin muscular vertical interauricular septum, the membrane which divides the left and the right auricles into two separate chambers. This membrane, this interauricular septum, it has a small cavity-like structure, a small central oval area, which is known as fossa ovalis. Basically, it is a remnant. It is a remnant of the embryonic hole, what was known as foramen ovale. During the embryonic growth of the mammal, both the auricles are capable to communicate with each other. Basically, in the mammalian species, all the mammalian species, growth of the embryo is internal inside the mother's uterus, and all the materials which are needed by the growing embryo and subsequently by the fetus is supplied through the umbilical cord via the placental structure. Hence, in that phase of the life of any mammalian individual, both side of the heart is receiving similar kind of blood, and in order to have an efficient supply, both auricles are capable to communicate with each other through this passage, the wall which is dividing the right and the left ventricle. That wall has a gate, there is a passage, a hole. That hole is known as foramen ovale. However, this passage gets sealed immediately after the birth. In fact, foramen ovale start reducing in the size just before the birth, and immediately after birth of a mammalian young one, within a next very few days after the parturition, this foramen ovale seals completely. So this oval like shape, what is referred as the fossa ovalis, it is basically the remnant of that passage which was existing in the embryonic stage of a mammalian heart. The blood goes from right auricle to left auricle without entering in the lungs, which are not yet functional in during the embryonic phase. The foramen ovale is closed in the adults when lungs become fully functional. The inner lining of the auricular wall forms a network of low muscular ridges, which are known as musculi pectinati. There are small, very small protruding structures in the inner side of the auricular wall, and these foldings, these ridges, they are known as musculi pectinati. The right auricle receives venous or deoxygenated blood from each and every part of the body except lungs by or with the help of two different major veins known as superior vena cavae, or they are also referred as the precaval, left precaval and right precaval. Also, there is a third vein which brings the deoxygenated blood to the right auricle, and inferior central vena cava, what is known as the postcaval vein. So they altogether, there are three vena cavae, two superior and one inferior, or we can refer them as the two precavals and one postcaval veins, which are bringing deoxygenated blood from the different systemic tissues of the rabbit body and pouring it into the right auricle of the rabbit heart. All of them, they have separate opening in the right auricle. The opening of the inferior vena cava or the postcaval is partially guarded by a rudimentary Ischian valve. The left auricle, in contrast, receives blood which is aerated or which is oxygenated in the lungs, and the entire blood which is coming from the both left and right lungs, they fuse together to form the common pulmonary opening, and that enters through the posterior wall of the left auricle as a central opening. Both the auricles, they open posteriorly into the respective corresponding ventricles through their auriculoventricular aperture, and these apertures on both the sides, that means the right auricle opens into the right ventricle and the left auricle opens into the left ventricle respectively, and these opening of auricle to ventricle is very well guarded with the help of valves. On the right hand side, there is a right auriculoventricular valve known as tricuspid valves. The name is tricuspid because it is made up of three cusps, triangular flap-like structures, hence the name is given as the tricuspid valve. Whereas on the left hand side, the right auricular aperture is guarded by a two flap valve, hence it is known as bicuspid valve. It is also known as mitral valve. The ventricles, which are the lower chambers, which are the larger volume of the heart, is also divided entirely or completely into left and right chamber by an oblique vertical interventricular septum, and that makes the rabbit heart into a complete four-chambered structure. The left ventricle is comparatively thick-walled and larger than the right ventricle, and it is circular in the transverse section. If you cut a TS from the top, it looks like a circular structure. So this is the internal features or structures of a rabbit heart, how it looks like. So here you can see This is the remnant of the ischial wall. This is the left precaval opening. This is the opening of the right precaval. And this is the opening of the postcaval or the inferior vena cava. So these are the three openings through which all the deoxygenated blood of the body is collected and added in the right auricle of the rabbit's heart. And then it passes through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle, from where it is being pumped through this single median aorta that is known as the pulmonary aorta to the two different lungs for oxygenation. And then all the oxygenated blood returns from the left and the right lungs, and they fuse together behind the heart wall and opens as the single opening, that is the pulmonary opening in the left auricle of the heart. And from where the oxygenated blood flows into the left ventricle, and from the left ventricle it is pumped through the single opening corticosystemic arc or the corticosystemic aorta. So the smaller right ventricle is crescentic in the transverse section. I have not kept any TS of the rabbit's heart diagram. The inner wall of the ventricle is having a much larger ridges with comparison to the auricles, where we have seen the minute ridges on their inner wall, similar to them, but they are much protruded and they are much immersed. These ridges in the ventricles, they are referred as the columnar carinae. These structures are very important in the functioning of opening and closing of the bicuspid and the tricuspid valves of the heart. So besides these carinae, there are some papillary muscles are also present in the ventricles, and these papillary muscles are connected, the columnar carinae or the papillary muscles, they are connected to the thin ligamentous structure. These thin ligamentous structures are known as chordae tendineae. So let's revisit the structures, because there are so many names, so you may get confused. So there are some ridges in the wall of the ventricle. These are known as columnae carinae. Besides these ridges, there are some large conical ridges. They are known as papillary muscles. And then we have fine ligamentous structure that is known as chordae tendineae. Now these chordae tendineae, they are connecting the free ends of the bicuspid valves of the left hand side to their wall, and the free edges of the tricuspid valves to the walls or the papillary muscles or columnar carinae of the right side. And it is because of the contraction and relaxation of these papillary muscles, these valves open and close. When we will discuss the working mechanism of the heart, it will become more clear that because of the contraction of these chordae tendineae, the bicuspid and the tricuspid valves of the rabbit heart opens and closes. So the tricuspid and bicuspid valves between the left and the right auriculoventricular apertures respectively allow the passage of blood only in one direction, that is from the auricles into the ventricles, and it does not allow the backflow of blood from the ventricle to the auricles. And the nature of this one-way traffic of blood from the auricles to the ventricles and not allowing it to move from the ventricles back to the auricles are basically due to the presence of these auriculoventricular valves, what we refer as the tricuspid valve on the right hand side and bicuspid valve on the left hand side. A single pulmonary aorta arises from the right ventricle, which carries the deoxygenated blood to the lungs for oxygenation. And similarly, there is a single systemic aorta, or what is known as the carotico-systemic aorta, which arises from the left ventricle and which carries oxygenated blood to the different parts of the body. Both these aortae, whether it is the pulmonary aorta, which is arising from the right ventricle, or whether it is the carotico-systemic aorta, which is arising from the left ventricle, both of them independently are protected or guarded by three semilunar valves. These valves are known as semilunar because of the nature of these valvular structure, which is crescent shape, and the presence of these semilunar valves assures that the blood which is once pumped from the ventricles to the respective aortae, they will not flow back into the ventricles. So the opening of the left ventricle is in the left ventricle is also guarded by the three semilunar valves of the systemic aorta, and in the blood vessel which is arising from the right ventricle, that is the pulmonary aorta, it is also being guarded by the three semilunar valves. So at the place, now this is the last thing to be discussed in the structure of the rabbit's heart, that at the place where the carotico-systemic aorta crosses the pulmonary aorta, there is a small muscular strand that is known as the ligamentum arteriosum, which is present in the adults. But during the embryonic structure, this ligamentum arteriosum is basically a small connecting artery that is known as ductus arteriosus, or it is also referred as the Bottoli. So if you look at closely, it is not very clearly seen here, but I think yes, here in this particular diagram you can see this is the ligamentum arteriosum where the two aortae, they are interconnected, but this is the remnant, this is the, this ligamentum here also you can see. So this is the ligamentum arteriosum, this is the remnant of ductus arteriosus. Ductus arteriosus used to be functional in the same way as that of the foramen ovale. So that is the passage of the two auricles in the same way. Both the aortae, they were also able to communicate with each other during the embryonic growth phase. So that ductus arteriosus is a thin artery which was connecting the systemic aorta with that of the pulmonary aorta during the embryonic stage. But subsequently upon the birth, this reduces, it degenerates, and in the adults it is remnant, is what we call as the ligamentum arteriosum. So this much is the detail of the internal structure of the rabbit's heart, and also we have discussed the functions and the organization of the rabbit's blood. So for this session, this much is all. All these material I have collected with the help of the two major Indian textbook which I am using. One is Modern Textbook of Zoology, Vertebrates by R.L. Kotpal, and second book which I am referring is Chordate Zoology by P.S. Verma. All the images which I have used for this presentation and video is downloaded from Google Images. Thank you all. Please keep watching my channel. You will get to see more of the things. And wait for my next lecture in which I'm the part two of the circulatory system of rabbit, where I'll discuss with you the details of arterial and veins of the rabbit vascular system. Thank you.